All right, here's the next flipper. Now, you guys know I like to pick up the cars that are, you know, they can have a lot of miles or they can be blown engine or this and that, but I like to pick them up clean, something that it's not really trashed. So all he needs is, you know, that if I replace the engine, it's gonna be good. Or you know that if it has high mileage but the body's clean, it's something wrong with the engine. I rarely buy something that is wrecked or something that it's like a door or something. I will get also this thing. It's a 1997 Honda Odyssey, and this thing's more like a wagon. It's a four-door, but it's a minivan. It's clean on the inside. I mean, it's dirty, but what I mean clean is like it's not trashed. Everything's here, no rips, no nothing. I bought this, he said he ran in drives. It was an impound, and it's clean on the inside. Everything's there. Dirty, but it's not trashed. That's what I'm trying to say. It has a third row seat. It looked like they took good care of it. So that's like a rack for something. I think it's a bike or camping, or I don't know, but that's coming off. And the only damage, it was here. And the damage on this van was they tried to steal it, or they stole the van, and he ended up in an impound. Obviously, you can see the damage. They pried the door open, and the only thing I'm gonna probably try to fix is the door and the door handle. Now, these vans are very rare to come across, so if not, then I have to fix it, because I don't want to paint it, and they're really hard to come by. I think the tires are brand new. I think what I can pull out of this van is it would be almost the same as if I fix the door or not. If I can sell this thing, I don't know, for $1,800, $1,500, I'll be happy with it. So AC runs and drives. I'm gonna put the jumper on, and we're gonna find out. All right, first thing I like to check is the coolant. Coolant's on level, so that's a good sign. And then the oil, you can see it's on level, so that's another good sign. It's not milky, it's just clean. And it looks like it has a brand new serpentine belt. That's a good sign too. That means they took care of it. It's a little bit oily, but I mean, most Hondas are like that at this age. What else? I don't see a timing belt sticker that they've been replaced. I don't see none of that, but we'll probably take a peek at it. And the starter looks new also. The clamp has a new clamp. The battery looks new. You can see the service. They service the battery at the dealership. It has a Honda battery. So let's hear it. Let's see what it does. Of course, typical Honda. 250,000 miles, 250,000 miles. No check engine light. Is the doors open? I didn't see all doors are open, but maybe it's because this one. No. Oh, I remember that door. It's gonna say it's open. They probably busted that in there, and that's why it says that. But you can see the van is, for its age, it's taken care of. Interior's clean. The seats are not ripped. And this thing pretty much looks like an Accord and a Prelude mixed on the inside. So I'm gonna go ahead and unhook it. I'm gonna leave it running so it charges the battery. And then, one of the things I wanted to check out was AC, because this is what's gonna sell this van. If the AC works, that's what's gonna sell this van. It's gonna be the AC, because it is hot. Alright, so I'm gonna go ahead and try to fix the door. Like I said, the only thing that it looks to me, it looks like when they pried it, the pillar, the door trim around it, they bent it. Obviously, they bent it out. So I have an idea of how to try to fix it so it sits flush. Just bear with me. That looks like about it. The top looks fine. All this is gonna come off. I have that acid that I sprayed, and that's gonna remove all that
sticker residue, but I'm not worried about none of this right now. I'm worried about the door. You guys saw the big old gap. And that's why they use tape, because they bent it, out, or it didn't, it would have, it probably had a lot of air or the water would go through, so then tweakers. So this was a death recovery. And the way they sold it is, you can see where they pried it, shoved something in here, they pried it out. And for sure it's gonna need a door handle. Right now what I'm gonna try to do is, I'm gonna try to seal this more in. All it is, it's popping out from here. So what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna try to pry it out very carefully. You can see where, this is where they shoved it in and they ripped. So they ripped this out, so it's probably gonna need this out, but there's a way to fix these. Another thing is, like I said, I'm gonna pry this out with a screwdriver slowly. Once it makes it in there, then I crimp them again. I'll crimp them again with some pliers, and you'll see how this gets fixed. And once that's done, if it shuts like it does in the top, I'm gonna hit it one more time just because I can still see it. But I think once I do this, it's gonna help. What happened is that it tried to unweld from here also, so that's why it's that. I'm gonna fix that, and then if it's closed, it's good. I think I'm gonna leave it alone. I'm not gonna replace the door. The door is not damaged. What's damaged, actually, it's this door. They dented it here, but it's an older vehicle. It's got a few dings, but that's it. All right, I think that's just as best as it's gonna get. See that? It's not gonna look perfect, but it's a used car. My main concern was just the gap on the top, which is all gone. So now what I did is, like I showed you guys, I did it with the screwdriver. This is for door panels, locker things, clips. So I popped it open all the way. I pried it open, the crease, and then that, because it's a skin, and then it went back in, and I closed it back with the pliers. And then after I did that, I went ahead and hit it with the hammer. I mean, you're gonna probably notice it, but I think it's definitely better than how it came, and I'm not gonna worry about. All right, I put the acid, and the acid is not taking it off that great. So what I did, I went ahead and poured some gas, just regular gas, and then get one of these Scotch-Brites, and it takes it off very easy. Just don't sit there and scrub it, because then you're gonna have to buff it. But you can see, just barely gently scrub it and it'll remove it. Okay, in this videos, there's gonna be three cars. There's gonna be that Honda that I bought. There's gonna be the Honda Odyssey, 97 Honda Odyssey. There's 96 Honda Accord. There's another 96 Honda Accord. Is it worth fixing older 90s cars? Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. This car came in because of lower ball joint, and it's been replaced. Everything's good, nothing's wrong with it. Then after the ball joints, the rear wheel bearing was out in one of them, on one side, so they didn't know which one was it. They replaced both. We have a parts car, and the speed sensor was out. Luckily we had a speed sensor. And then after that, there was a wiring issue that somehow that's the main harness, so they would have said no. So all that harness plugs into all these fans, turn signals, all that. Long story short, this car's fixed because we had a parts car. It was worth fixing it. He can probably post it for $1,500 and it's interior's clean.
The outside is trash, but the car runs and drives, and it has AC, and it runs good. This car, it was worth fixing. This car, on the other hand, came over because of a customer. He said, you know what? I already spent money in the battery, brand new battery, brand new distributor, brand new starter, and fuel pump. He spent money, and the car sounds like it wants to start, but it won't start. He says, I cannot get the car to start, and I think it's because it's, he said, it was either, he replaced the main relay. He said it's an electrical issue. So here I come in, right? Electrical issue, 97 Honda Accord. To me, this one is beat up. I wouldn't have saved it, but he wants to spend a little extra money. He already spent a lot of money, battery, distributor, starter, fuel pump. I'm pretty sure it has new spark plugs too. This car, that's a damage, but he was probably gonna pop that out, replace the windshield, call it a day. Other than that, the body is good all around. Like I said, this one's way better condition than that one. That one's manual, this one's automatic. Totally different people. The guy that runs that drives a BR6, he bought it just to flip it. Quick flip. This one's in a lot better shape, interior, everything. But this one has a big issue. It had an aftermarket alarm. I had to delete the alarm. I had to delete all that to get to it, because we wouldn't get no power to the distributor. Anyways, long story short, this car, it sounds, you guys are gonna hear it crank. It sounds like it wants to start, and it'll fool with you, and you'll see. I have a gator clip attached to the starter, because I wouldn't wanted to figure it out over here. You'll hear it. So what's funny is that it sounds like it has compression. You need compression, you need fuel and spark to start the car. First red flag, the car didn't have spark. Why didn't it have spark? They replaced the distributor, I already mentioned it. The car will still not start. And it sounds like it has good compression, right? We checked the compression, cylinder number one, it has good compression, okay. He did say, he did mention the number one and four had good compression, and the two middle ones, he says, it had like low compression, but it still had compression. That's why the engine sounds like that. Okay, well, this is where it gets, when I used that car as a dummy tester to switch this distributor over there, car starts fine. Put that one over here, doesn't start. But where it got my attention was, I took this distributor out three times or four times, and all four times it was in the same location. You can see that. So I thought it was funny, you know, I've been chasing my tail for a while, and I thought that was funny because if it has good compression, it has like 80 in the two middle ones, and it has like 180 in the two outsider ones. I was like, the car should at least, you know, attempt to start. But what caught my attention was that it's always in the same spot. It seems like they broke that and they JB welded there. So that caught my attention, and that's when I decided to pull the distributor out and watch this. You can crank and that thing wouldn't turn. So I came over, took the valve cover off, and sure enough, now watch this. This thing has a broken cam. That's what the issue is. The camshaft is broken from right there. It won't turn all the way on the back. It's none of that camshaft spins, none of them. Only the main sprocket, so it's broken from right here. Now, there is another bigger issue. This guy said, when he brought it over, he said, the car has a bad oil leak. You guys can see. This car leaks oil big time. Now, I think what happened is the car was ran low on oil and that camshaft broke. That camshaft broke right there because oil starvation. I'm pretty sure the journals are beat up or chewed up here, and that cam locked. And I don't want to mess with it. It's got a lot more problems. Like I said, that I'm gonna be honest and I'm gonna tell him, you know what? Here's your car. You owe me $150, and I know exactly what the problem is, and I'm gonna show him.
All right. I thought I was finished with this van. And I like to leave things the way they're supposed to be. That way later, you know, later down the road, a customer doesn't come back and say, hey, this and that. AC wouldn't work. We charged it, leaked, went to Ricardo, took it, and he found the leak. And the leak was a hose. So we had to take all this off because this thing has AC on the rear, old school. The line runs all the way through there. It's this thin line right here. And had a pinhole right here. Catch it. So I soldered it, no more leaks. And still no cold air. So I'm trying to find out why, and I figured it out. At one point, somebody got into the radio, I think probably to pull the serial number out of it. Because these things, usually use a serial number on them. And took everything apart. You have to take all this apart to get to it. The problem was here. As you guys can see it, somebody didn't connect it. So that's all there's to it. I manually did it down there. You can do it manually. And then right away, boom, there goes cold air. It was stuck in hot, so now we have cold air. But I don't want to leave it like that, because then this guy here in Central Oregon, there's days that it's, today it was hot. It's going to be hot for the next couple of weeks, but eventually it's going to start getting colder. People can deal without AC, but here in the winter, it's a must to have the heater running. So I got to make this right. So it only took me a few more minutes, took everything apart. And at the same time, I'm gonna get the code for that, because he needs the radio's asking for those. The dealer's asking for the serial number from the radio so they can give you the code for it. And obviously, you can't get it because it's in here. On the newer ones, I think it's 98 and up, you can press 1 and 6, hold it, and it'll give you the serial number, but these older ones won't. So, we'll kill two birds with one stone. I'm gonna fix this, I'm gonna get the serial number. That way, we leave it running how it's supposed to be. So yeah, that's that. So anyways, quick fix, gotta put that on, put everything back, get the serial number, put it back, should be running good now.